thank you more warmly for coming along. It's a great encouragement to see so many people here this evening, so thank you for that. Corporal Ted Foster, Victoria Cross, Hero of Tooting. That's the title of my talk. I think it's interesting to explore the newer countries that bubbled up in Europe in the 20th century, majority of them born out of stale, outdated empires. So as it were from scratch, they had to define their new nationhood and they had to identify heroes, men and women who they admired for their achievements and for their noble qualities. And then, of course, they had to promote them locally or abroad via banknotes and by stamps. So here you see Alexander Dubček, Slovak-born, a democratic politician who demonstrated considerable bravery in 1968. Hungary, from quite a large pool, chose Martos Flora, a woman famous in the 1930s in Hungary. She was an industrial chemist and a humanitarian note. Ireland, lovely, literate Ireland, chose one of its wordsmiths as a hero at one stage for a stamp. And here we have Bram Stoker, the hysterical, witless with his stories. Heroes are essential. They symbolize a proud past for us, and they define a sense of group character or personality. And just as I'm talking about new nations, so those needs apply to people like ourselves. We live in an enormous conurbation, but we, many of you here, live actually in Tooting itself, many others of you live in the borough of Wandsworth. We need heroes too. And I would argue that the towering example of a hero for the borough of Wandsworth, and specifically for the district of Tooting, is indeed Corporal Ted Foster. So over the next 40 minutes or so, I intend to create an impression of Foster and of his life. My interpretation, of course, it's unique, but it nevertheless is valid, and I hope you will gain interest. And I hope what one or two of you are saying beforehand, you'll gain new insights. I mean that respectfully, but new insights into a subject which has been covered by quite a few others. So, I don't want to spend too much time on his valorous detail, on his valorous deed. Partly because I'm not a military historian, it simply doesn't float my boat, that level of minutiae of battles and campaigns. And also because, from your own membership, I know this has been covered very well elsewhere, as they say. But I do want to focus on the events that directly came out of his moment of glory, the impact they had on us and our community in this part of London, and also the impact on him following his herohood, and later on to explore some parallels with others who, I can only say, were there at that moment when, as a consequence, they were cast as heroes, and their lives, as a consequence, were changed out of all recognition. Edward Foster was born in 1886, about a kilometre or so north of here, as I think many of you know. When I rehearsed this at home this afternoon, I was going to point to two or three things on the screen, but I think I might hold off for a second. I simply will identify. He was born in Tooting. He was born in Tooting Grove, which still exists, of course, though not in that form. Noted even at the time as an area of some deprivation, poor housing. Not sure the date of those houses, but early last century, probably 1820, no more recent than that. So there you can see Tooting Grove from southeast to northwest on this map. This map's 1894 edition of Ordnance Survey. So by the time he was a lad growing up, say 6 or 8 years old, so he'd become increasingly aware just that large block north or northeast of Tooting Grove, an isolation hospital. I wonder if that affected him. It must have had some brooding, menace is too strong, but source of concern that it was, as you can see from the caption, it was an infectious disease, this hospital. Interesting, before we leave this slide, is there's Fountain Road. That is the road running from the top centre over towards your left-hand side. Fountain Road is where Ted lived with his wife Alice after their marriage, right the way through to his death. You can see in 1894 it was only partially built. Now, of course, it's both sides. It houses both sides in the road. I went along, strolled there a couple of weeks ago in anticipation of the talk. Must say, I didn't get a conclusive feeling, but I had a strong persuasive feeling that indeed in this 1890s map, his house was already built. It was one of those on the northern side of the road, as appeared here. And he left school, or we would say early. Late Victorian or Edwardian working class people would not, they would say in due time. Children were an economic asset. If you had very little money coming in, you got them out of school as quick as you reasonably could and into work. And he worked just round the corner in what was then euphemistically called the dust destructor. So his first job was as a dustman, or as a refuse collector. I found this fabulous photograph on a London Life website. Very little provenance. People bung these pictures up, but you don't always know what they are. Clearly London, but no indication of its locale, of its locality. Date presumed to be 1903. Now that's handy, that's useful, because that is when Ted Foster was in his early days as a refuse collector. And that, I think it is reasonable to suppose, that's precisely the sort of vehicle he'd be involved with. Horse-drawn, if you could see, to the left, in front of the buildings obviously, but close left, you can just see 1.5 ears of that same horse. You can almost smell the vehicle. I think those baskets are pretty rank around the back. Heaven knows what went into those. But I found this particularly powerful and particularly appealing because we're looking into the faces of men in 1903. And those men, as a type, I must say that sort of phrase with respect, of course, but as a type, those could well have been the very colleagues, the older colleagues, the ones who sent him round the corner for a tin of elbow grease and all those sort of larks that we all experience as youngsters. Those are the type of people and the clothing, the people that he would have been working with. But then the walking, as we all know, a room of historians, I hope we're strong with our chronology, the war came, and Ted Foster enlisted pretty quickly with a call to arms in this borough in 1915 to set up Powell's battalion. He joined that in advance of conscription in January 1916. We need to know that. Part of it, salary, of course, he paid, not salary, but paid, but it was a volunteer army that he joined. And he enlisted in the 13th Battalion, that's the Wandsworth Battalion of the East Surrey Regiment, and will have undergone some form of initial training. So we need to move forward from that. His training, moving across to France, and now we're getting to the nub, indeed, of our whole talk, of the location of his moment of glory, and indeed the specific date. I am talking about the 24th of April 1917. War on the go for nearly 4 years. Sense of despair at home. Commentators noted there was a feeling that the war would never end. That spring saw the start of the Arras offensive in northern France. So let's get a locality of what we're talking about. Because Ted Foster, with his battalion, was at a tiny village, and goodness me, I do mean tiny, even now, tiny village of Villers-Plouich. And there it is, northern France is occupied Belgium. You can see the lines are modern lines, but of course it's German-occupied territory there. There's Lille, which for the whole of the war seems to have been, for the enemy, a place of recreation, and that is a euphemism. Villa Bluish was, and indeed still is, of course, 8 miles southwest of the large town of Cambrai, all in German hands. And Foster, with his mates, with his colleagues, were held up. The advance could not be made into the village to try and reclaim that territory back for the Allies because of 2 entrenched German machine guns. And Foster went forward with a lance corporal. So for our purposes, Foster was the senior rank, so he went forward to attack those gun emplacements. It will no doubt surprise you, not surprise you, no. I don't have a photograph of Foster going forward and fighting with those men, but I do have this. As part of my research for talk, I went to the archives of the Illustrated London News, and this image appeared approximately 2 weeks after the battle on the 24th of April. This specifically reflects and represents the British fighting in the Arras offensive, and rather primly the caption says that the artist's impression made from material supplied by an eyewitness. Now let's call this out for what it is, 1 century on. This is wholesale British propaganda, isn't it? Look, by way of a coincidence, all the men who've got their arms in the air and are surrendering, they happen to be Germans. Astonishing. Every person who seems to be killed, how fascinating, they're all the enemy. Admittedly, there is a token individual, a Brit, who has been injured. Bottom right-hand corner, you see a trooper who has sustained what in Hollywood terms can only be described as just a flesh wound. But then, if I move my comments to one side, I find this an exceedingly moving illustration because, for me, it captures the harrowing thrill of it all, and I think that's even another statement. The catch-your-throat drama, the utter grip of terror, I feel, of those men on both sides. Key point, of course, this illustration gives to me, it's not large guns across a no-man's land. This is so close that some fighters could practically grab the bayonets in front of them. Now, to say that's thrilling is the ultimate understatement. I mean, not thrilling for us, I don't mean that. I mean, the thrill that will have gone through those combatants. I can only assume, just, or in a manner of speaking, blind with fear, the terror must have gripped those men beyond description. So from that I think gives us just a glimpse of the emotion that Foster must have gone through as he went forward to those trenches. He threw a couple of grenades, and in the wording of the time, he wiped out the crews. Now that's another euphemism, of course. He killed all the men. It's true, it's a case of the most vicious fighting. But as a direct consequence of that act, he enabled his company to advance and to sweep through the village. The village of Villa Bluey was regained for the Allies. Our side could consolidate and ready to move forward in this offensive. So it is true to say, I think it's fair to say, that Foster's act was an act of almost reckless courage. There can be no pragmatic thought, there can be no weighing up the pros and cons at that moment. The achievement was that we were combatants, the achievement was that we were able to move forward. And almost immediately, his senior officers recognised the significance of what he'd done. So within a short space of time, news had got back to London. And by the end of June, so that's only about 7 weeks further on, Corporal Foster was gazetted. And this is a cutting from the London Gazette on the supplements at the end of June, a list of many men. He's indeed one of them, and his citation for the award of the Empire's greatest honour, the Victoria Cross. to the top, Corporal Edward Foster, East Surrey Regiment. Notice the line below for most conspicuous bravery and initiative. This was Foster, Dustman of Tooting. The following month, so we're into July 1917. Remember, we know how it ends. They didn't. They didn't know when there was going to be an armistice. But he was granted leave to come home. He returned home. He went to his home, of course, in Fountain Road. A reporter from the Tooting and Balham Gazette was there, along with the crowds outside his house where he met his wife Alice again. I'll come back to the theme again of what I perceive to have been a profile of this personality, which is one of shyness, of deference. Maybe that of what was a factor of lower level working class life in Victorian and Edwardian London. But I think it's quite reasonable to suppose the two of them would have been disquieted by the people outside. So if that wasn't harsh enough, within days they were invited to attend a meeting of the full council of the Metropolitan Borough of Wandsworth. Now that took place in the council house. That's Book House, now residential accommodation on East Hill. And according to the Borough News reporter, when they entered the room, I find this very moving, there were several seconds of a standing ovation. They then sat down and they were treated something like 30 minutes of speeches. Now, I'm not terribly shy. Yeah, I think I'd be squirming. I just ground just swallowing me up. 30 minutes of statements of praise from maturer councillors from all the wards, of course, so that were right across the large borough of Wandsworth in those times. So this was great exposure to public attention. And of course later, perhaps after you've returned, but nevertheless press coverage as well. So the scene is late July 1917. Ted Foster is here in London. The weather is beautiful. It was determined that there would be a major occasion that Saturday, the 21st of July, that Saturday, where the King would personally would award Victoria Cross, the Victoria Cross. Where it panned out, because the weather was so wonderful, was that the event would take place in the forecourt of Buckingham Palace, and that the event was widely publicised. This was intended quite determinedly by the officialdom that this should be a morale booster. And large crowds gathered, and we have this really quite fascinating photograph, press photograph, of large crowds. There were larger crowds in the base of the Victoria Memorial, and here are people looking through the central railings and towards Aston Webb's facade of Buckingham Palace. Queen Mary was up on the balcony, and the Daily Express said in a gossipy fashion, the weather was so hot, the Queen left off her hat. King instructed that various wounded service personnel were brought into the courtyard, and then they had to be shifted because the sun was in their eyes. There was a delay before it started. I want to go into this in some detail because I find this really quite gripping. The award of Victoria Cross was to go to 24 men. Who were present, of course, 24 men. And in addition, the presentation of the medal to bereaved families, those are posthumous awardings for the family members who have died. So let's focus on the 24. As is the nature of those events, there's a hierarchy. They were in order of rank. But beyond that, and the press picked up on this, we want to think to see the significance. Every individual man was granted the same moment, the same structure of his time with the King. So this is really a democratising moment, and the press picked up on this. I suppose implicit in this, we're saying, is that our monarchy is surviving the war, our monarchy is fine and to continue to be respected, and by extension, you wouldn't expect the Tsar or the Kaiser to be greeting working class people, people as lowly, comment of the time, lowly as dustmen. But that's indeed what happened. Now, fortunately, just a bit to the right of this picture, there was a cinematograph operator, a member of the Pathé company, and he took some film through the railings. And here is a still I've taken. I must say, unashamedly, I've taken this from the British Pathé Archive website. They don't know it, but I'm very grateful to them. Very grateful to them for not realising I've taken it. So there we are. There we've got the scene. I know, and I know that you know, this is not Ted Foster. Oh, I don't have, that doesn't seem to have survived. Nevertheless, in every other aspect, I hope you feel you're going to the very spirit of the moment when Foster got his award. The man there, to the right, of course, with the king, man seems to be an Aussie digger with a slouch hat. I'm pretty certain he's another rank. Indeed, as Foster, of course. He's a Dominion serviceman. But in other respects, this is how it would have looked when Foster moved forward, and those people in the railings would have seen it. Behind the king is Colonel Wigram, who is his private secretary, with a sheaf of paper. He read out the citation. The man then came forward and saluted his monarch, Emperor of India, King of the United Kingdom. Behind the gentleman on the left, who is a stills photographer, is a small table covered in medals. So one by one, an officer brought the medal forward to the king. King pinned the medal on Foster's left chest, and then, notice this, and George V did this with every one of the 24, he shook hands. And this is new. Victoria didn't shake hands with it. Edward VII didn't shake hands with working class people. This is the monarchy trying to keep pace. Later commentators say that George V had an apprehension, terror perhaps, that revolution would take over. And of course, millions of men knew how to fire a rifle. Let us not forget that. So perhaps with a thumping heart, the king was meeting his people in a way that previous monarchs had not done so. Ceremony over. Ted Foster, there he is with his medal. A couple of flags behind. Foster went back to France. Returned to front. I said, what do we see? They didn't know how it's going to end. I sometimes think our instinctive response is, oh, for heaven's sake, give the man a break. It's only another 15 months. Shackleton's men, this is a bit, shouldn't go, I've been off script. Shackleton's men returned from the Antarctic and immediately went off to fight. It seems so unfair, but the war was on the go. So he went back to France. He was wounded in the following year, though not severely, and was discharged at the end of 1918. Foster came back to Tooting and returned to his role as a refuse collector. Now, at this point, of the talk, our road splits into two. We've come to a fork, a junction. So we've got two roads for us to go down, and we're going to go a little bit of way down each of the roads. The first one, I want to explore with you the impact of Ted Foster's action on us, on the history of the London Borough of Wandsworth, because there is a legacy, and I think it's fair that if he had not acted in such a brave fashion in Villa Pluijsje, that path wouldn't have happened. Just would not have happened. So directly due to him. Talk about that in a second. And then roadway two is to recognise this shy, this self-effacing man, and how he became exposed with an unseen hand, was drawn irresistibly into high-profile events, the full blaze, 1920s context, media coverage. And I've got three examples there. We'll talk about each of those in turn in a few moments. But let's just stay with the first part, which is this point about Ted Foster's legacy to the Borough of Wandsworth and to us. with the coming of peace in 1918 into 1919, there was a feeling bubbling up in British everyday life, civilian life, of course, the British life. There was an increasing sense of discomfort, which I would perhaps diagnose as a layman, diagnose as survivor's guilt. The argument went, poor Belgium, gallant little Belgium, that was overrun, that was lost and was devastated. But France, for heaven's sakes, France, what if France had fallen? What would have happened? We could well have been next. And all those stories in those Edwardian invasion novels could have applied to us. So there was this mounting feeling that we have a duty to pay our debt. So by the beginning of 1920, they had formed the British League of Help. And their thrust was to invite towns, cities, metropolitan boroughs to identify and adopt devastated communities in northern France with a view to providing to support them. And we did that too. And we did that too. It wasn't an easy fight. The advocate that we should adopt Villa Plouiche was the mayor of the time, Lieutenant Commander Cooper Rawson. Comes back in our story a couple more times, so we'll go back to him a little bit later. But he was a thrusting force. But the counter-arguments were a bit of a slump, haven't got much money, and collecting money for overseas, we're not really on. No, 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 says Cooper Rawson, it's going to be goods in kind, so it's not as if we're taking money when we hardly have any money. But there is a nice snapshot. It's taken from the Times of October 30th, for the purest one, October 1920. I think it's an interesting consolidation of how successful, but the datum, no other yardstick, apparently successful this campaign had been, the British League of Help. 35 French towns adopted, helping to pay our debt. And I recognise I can't point, believe me. It's interesting to note that great big Birmingham took on Albert, which was heavily damaged. That was really the Virgin, the statue of the Virgin, taking the hand forward, but did not fall off the steeple. It's a very iconic image. Great big Newcastle, they took on Arras. That was the name given to the very offensive for Foster on his deed. And down near the bottom, just beyond the indent, four names up, you'll see, there's our proud place, once of having adopted Villa Plouiche. So, we'd agreed that. Bits of money coming in, there were a little bit of collection of bits and bobs, but it wasn't really maintaining much momentum at that stage in 1920. So Cooper Rawson decided he'd go across to visit the village. Let's have a look at him. I need to acknowledge my thanks to our colleagues, the Wandsworth Heritage Service at Battersea Library, of course I've taken from their website, taken this detail of a photograph. Those who might like to know a real local connection, well, unfortunately turn the phrase of cutting the first sod, but here is Cooper Rawson, just about to dig the first piece of turf for the Firsdown estate here in Tooton. Wearing his robes of state the way you do when you have a spade in your hand. Now, he went across to Villa Plouiche in October 1920. The intention was to talk to villagers, to see how they're getting on, to judge their welfare, and to see what sort of things they might need for their buildings within the village itself. And you can guess the next sentence. Cooper Rawson was utterly appalled. Utterly. His shock comes through in his report in the paper later that month. This is a photograph from the Cambrai archive. This is Villa Plouiche, photographed, I would imagine, the very beginning of 1919. It scarcely had enough labour and workforce to clear away the debris in the road. Not a single building was standing, but the railings to the right, those are walls, but no roof on anything like that. To his horror, Cooper Rawson found something like 600 people living in shacks. They'd gone, because the fighting, the war was all around them. The war was over. The war had been all around them. So they were just taking debris, corrugated iron, planks of wood, and were living out a very bleak existence. An agrarian population of farmers, but the fields are pulverized, so they're scarcely able to resume their task. So he came back with renewed enthusiasm and was a driving force, as were his successors through the 1920s. No need to rebuild. The Germans were going to do that because of the, as a result of the, we now perceive as cruel reparation demands from from Versailles, and we all know the unfortunate outcome of those crushing terms. But we were going to provide help, the wherewithal to get the community back on its feet again. And in the event, by 1930, we'd raised, or we, I mean our predecessors, had raised £1,250. It's always dodgy saying, well, how much is that now? I don't really know, but I do have a perception that's probably about £75,000. Nearly all in money, of course. Some clothing, I believe, but really otherwise, no, they were donations, charity events and football matches, that sort of thing. But we provided agricultural equipment and we provided materials for the school, education materials, exercise books, and things like that. By May 1930, British League of Help, as it were, had run its course. The momentum had run out and there was a civic celebration in Paris, and the mayors of all the participating towns or boroughs went across. Jolly, I suppose. They went across, and our mayor in 1930, by coincidence, his name was Tom Cox. Pure coincidence, I think, of the MP of this constituency about a dozen years or so ago. But Tom Cox went along, and here is a photograph taken during his visit in May 1930, as it appeared in the Borough News the following couple of weeks. And there you can see the mairie, a cluster of school children. And there you see, in English, that banner just below the upper windows, heartfelt thanks to Wandsworth. And it does not underemphasize that to say that without Foster's valorous deed, we wouldn't have been in that situation. There would have been no requirement. There would have been no connection. So our link, our connection with that small communities directly as a result of Tim Foster and his gallant act. And the connection lives on. For your delectation and delight, ladies and gentlemen, is a picture of my good self. in my apartment to that photograph, we were there in the summer of 2007, so that was the 90th anniversary of Foster's deed. There is the same Mary. There's me holding the then current issue of the Wandsworth Historian. And you might just be able to make out, no, just believe me. Below the windows it says École de Filles on the left and École de Garçons on the right. So if you walk around the right hand side, that's where the school is, and there's a little space called a square, it's a little bit too grand, but there's a little space there. So we went around there, of course. As opposed to the other corner. It's very, very small. This is Villa Blue, it's just like those crosses. And ta-da, there we are, Lester Wandsworth. So our affectionate connection lives on. And as some of you may well know, as recently as this spring, representatives from the council and other taxpayers, residents of Wandsworth, went over there at their own expense, though. Great pains to emphasise that. They went across and they met Monsieur Machaut, who is the mayor of Villa Plouiche. So that connection carries on 100 years after Foster attacked those machine gunners. So there we are. That's the legacy we've had from Ted. Let us wind back to 1920. Tutti Dustman once again. A man not given to great publicity or great publicising, and yet nevertheless That's where the fates took the hand. And I've found three events. There are certainly more, but I've found three events where he was called upon, let us say, to be present. And I would think in the mores, the pressures of the time, they were irresistible. You just don't say no to mayors or to even senior officials than that. So the first one of the three, the first one is February 1920, when Queen Mary came to the borough and she went to a school, a Hotham Road school in Putney. And there we are. One press coverage item at the time said, "The Queen with the kiddies." So there you see right of centre, see Queen Mary in a long fur coat, which of course would not have caused would not be recognised in sensitivities that we feel now. It's a long time ago. So there she is. To her right is a lady. Some of you may well recognise that she's Princess Mary. Some of us of a certain age will remember her as the Princess Royal. And then on the right-hand side is Cooper Rawson. And of course, also present was Ted Foster, VC. Again, fortunately, Pathé were there, and so another still I've taken from their website. This is accessible to all of us, no question of subscription, it's accessible to all of us if you fish around a bit. Key with that 1920 clip, and the Queen and kiddies will get you there. I've particularly chosen this still. It really is very interesting. You see the Queen looking to the left and she's talking to a little girl with a berry on. Now this is Alice Kemp. Alice Kemp was I suspect, informally adopted daughter of Foster and his wife, also known as Alice. Foster's great niece, in communication with me 10 years ago, spoke of her very affectionately. So they took, I don't know what the origins are, I don't really want to know, that gets prurient, but she certainly lived in their own home. They had a son, Dennis, in 1923, so after this. So she's talking to the Queen, you see the mayor fidgeting around, almost going out of camera frame, and then, as it were, he hauls into the frame this enormous chap. Foster's about 6'5", 20 stone, described in the press as a gentle giant, and as much as we can interpret body language 97 years ago and on a slightly jerky film, he seems so ill at ease, you see him awkwardly moving forward, and the mayor guiding him around, and he moves to the left, and then he turns, and then he bows to his queen. But I sense, I sense his poor discomfort, and I feel for the man. There he was in this playground. We know you saw this previous photograph. And there are others as well. There would have been press photographers there, and there was a cinema cameraman hand cranking his machine. So he really did have, in 1920s terms, full blaze of glory. But as if that wasn't high enough profile, later on in the year, he really was participating in a ceremony, an event of towering emotion. Those of you with a love of history and a love of dates, if I tell you I'm talking about the 11th of November 1920. So that was the first true armistice as we would recognise it. The cenotaph, I wonder if you know, many of you may know this, I wonder, the original cenotaph was temporary. It was just a phenomenally powerful symbol, greatly exceeded. It was intended to be a piece of theatre. The power of it, simply astonishing. People power, I suppose. Officials were just utterly thrown, mountains of flowers. People, what were typically women, of course, widows and mothers, placing flowers. So it was reconstructed in Portland stone for 1920, the king was going to be inaugurated. Someone else, an army chaplain, came up with the idea. Wouldn't it be wonderful if the country had another focus? See, all bodies were abroad. By the end of 1914, there was no reinterment, no coming home. Those that fell were buried within the vicinity. No repatriation, as I'm not like Walter Bassett. It didn't happen. So part of this choking grief was you couldn't go to our son's grave. the thought came forward was immediately grasped that Britain required, needed, an unknown warrior. And notice the wording, a warrior, not a soldier. So notionally, in the abstract sense, notionally, it could be a naval personnel, it could have been a member of the Royal Flying Corps, but you know, in practical terms, it was a man who was killed in northern France. You may know that a suspected blindfolded officer went and touched a number of disinterred remains and coffins in a chapel at night. His hand placed on one of them, the others were reinterred, and then this body was brought home in great state, Boulogne and Dover, and then to London. And here we get this amazing panorama. Look at the crowds packed. So, King has struck his what the press called a gadget. The two vast Union flags tumbled down from the new cenotaph, the one that we know ourselves. 2 minutes silence had taken place. George V had placed his wreath of laurel on the coffin, and here the cortege is moving down to the bottom left-hand corner. So that means that it's moving south, down Whitehall, towards Parliament Square, and then round to Westminster Abbey for the interment of the unknown warrior. Planning stage, someone else had come up with another idea. Surely it would be fitting, the argument went, that upon arrival of the body in Westminster Abbey, it would pass between two lines of men, and they would, in the words of the time, they were to be a bodyguard of heroes. So notice the medievalism that informs us in Britain about our remembrance. We have a warrior. We talk of tombs, a cenotaph is an empty tomb of someone buried elsewhere, and now we're talking about heroes. This is the stuff of Mallory's Mort d'Arthur. This is the cult and the tone of chivalry. And the bodyguard of heroes was to be 100 men, recipients of the Victoria Cross. Ted Foster, of course, was invited and accepted. And then on the morning of the day, the Times actually reported, by His Majesty's especial wish, the heroes will be sized irrespective of rank. Now Foster says 6'5", so here he is by default thrown into, gentle pun intended, into such a prominent position. And so he was one of these two lines, you must presume, virtually the end, not only of those four ends, however it was placed, inside the abbey, waiting the arrival of the cortege. And here's this amazing press photograph, the coffin of the unknown warrior just making its way through the north door into Westminster Abbey. So I find it quite thrilling to realise that within seconds of that photograph being taken, the eyes of Ted Foster would have been on that flag, for sure. Don't doubt that. And also, it is reasonable to suppose that of the congregation down that end of the abbey, many of them at some stage within those moments, their eyes would have been on Ted Foster. So again, he was exposed to this high prominence and a place in a major ceremony. The third occasion I've chosen for those early post-war years, where again Ted was invited to participate, was in July 1923. You may know from social history there was an economic slump, reasonably high levels of unemployment, many servicemen had not found work. So with government support, local authorities were involved in job creation schemes. Here in Wandsworth, we built Southfields Estate, which some of you may know, Merton Road, just south of Southside Shopping Centre. And adjacent to that, of course, was Southfields Park, which we now know as King George's Park. And so, that day in July 1923, George and Mary paid a visit to Wandsworth. Again, just look at the crowds. There's the Royal Daimler, very thoughtfully with a spare tire on the roof, making its way, and in the background, those who know the area could see that it's those are the houses. They're the houses in Southfields. Then a busy afternoon, Queen Mary is guided off to meet bereaved mothers and widows. The king was guided off. True, you almost finished the sentence for me. In order to meet a number of local ex-servicemen, and of course the press were there, and of course there, in front of his diminutive sovereign, there's Ted, with his flat hat on, which I believe was the convention for discharged NCOs on an occasion such as this. That was accepted attire. I think it's reasonably certain to say that amongst those medals on his left chest, one of them, of course, would have been the Victoria Cross. Wandsworth Borough News loved this moment. In walking down the rank, he noticed Foster, who he honoured with an individual greeting. Poor Ted, a week later, found his name back in the papers again. There seemed to be no release of him from that media glare. We now live in an era where social media, the burden of fame is really quite intense. But the context of that time, that was quite out of reach. By then, Ted Foster had been for a number of years an employee once more of the Borough Council, and he was made a dusting inspector. Now, no such job existed. So it's a fiction. But the council deemed that it was valid, and so it's somewhat of a construction. And as explained to me by a colleague who was in the council, that meant, this is real personal, so those who like HR hierarchies, that meant that he was entitled to a greater pension fund. His pension entitlement was enhanced if and when he called upon it at retirement. And what happened in reality, he meant a survivor's pension went to Alice, which was enhanced because he was in an inspector role rather than merely a dust gatherer's role. 1937, 20 years after his valorous deed in Villa Pluiche, the Daily Express interviewed him. This is the photograph that appeared in the paper at the time, and the write-up is lyrical, if not completely patronising. It's certainly hagiographic, I think is the adjective. It's not, it ought to be. The writer said in 1937, "Sunshine oozes from this 20 stone of good nature." Pass me your hands, so I can bury my head in them. There we are. But it does reinforce this impression that I have from email discussion with a relative, and from reading contemporary comments that he was shy, self-effacing, good-natured, of goodwill. He died in 1946, just at the start of the year in January, aged only 59. Short illness is the statement. And at the time, the Streatham News said he was an unassuming and conscientious man. It doesn't apply to all, but when we think of heroes, as Band has stated, I don't like to talk about those of them, but when we think of heroes as a group, for many, a person can become a hero within a moment, which is as if fate has taken charge, and there they are, at that spot, at that moment in time, and as a consequence of the event, whatever the event is, they find themselves in the role of hero. So there's a serendipity about that very moment in time when the individual acquires the status of hero. It therefore does not follow the man or woman who is raised to hero status necessarily has the temperament to handle the situation they find themselves in. I think it's valid to recognise that. When I was considering a few weeks ago getting my head around the preparation of this talk, struck by coincidence in the press, struck by one hero that springs to mind was found the exposure of media and publicity practically intolerable. I'm speaking of this gentleman. This is Buzz Aldrin, United States astronaut. He is the second, not the first. He is the second person to walk on the moon. And it is well documented, so it's no breach of confidentiality. It's well recognized. Well, Mr. Aldrin is alive. Has been through three divorces, has been through bouts of crippling depression, and has suffered the impact of alcoholism. Now, I must say utterly, not for one split second, am I saying any of those social pressures fell on Ted Foster. But as a shy, as a kindly man, a man who was described as non-committal in his views, he never thought ill of anyone, said his great niece to me. So, just as the high-profile exposure to Buzz Aldrin caused him some pain, I think it is right to presume that they must have felt some burden. Ted Foster must have felt some burden, the exposure he had himself. Just look at this. This is from a national newspaper in 1920, from the Daily Sketch, tabloid, seen in a million homes, maybe more. And there the cartoon is. Humour of that cartoon is kindly, it's benign, but the draftsmanship is unblinking. We see a vast corporation of Corporal Foster, and he's flat out on as well. I just grabbed that because it just shows that 3.5 years on from his moment of great valour, he's still the subject of a feature drawing like that in a high-profile tabloid paper. There can be little doubt that he would have found that to some extent painful. Heroes are not always suited to the fame that follows them. So let's come into the last few minutes of my talk. I'd say it's tasteless, it's almost tactless, to draw any parallels between heroes. Indeed, by definition, we don't want, we want them to be unique, we don't want them to be similar. We certainly don't want them to be a better hero than another hero, as if you do performance reviews, that would be too frightful. But I'm intrigued to see in our own time that we have a more recent military hero whose story lends some comparisons with Ted Foster's. I'm speaking, of course, of Lance Sergeant Johnson Beharry, Victoria Cross. Sergeant Beharry was in Iraq in the spring of 2004 and on two occasions, close together. He acted with extreme valour, with great heroism, and as a result of his actions, he saved members of his unit from ambushes and was awarded the VC as a consequence. Sergeant Beharry comes from Grenada in the West Indies and is described as coming from a modest upbringing. To say that Foster came from a modest upbringing, that is a hint of luxury to it. But neither of these gentlemen came from what we might describe as comfortable backgrounds. They came from pretty lowly sources. Now, clearly, as you can see, Sergeant Beharry is a black man, a member of an ethnic minority group within our society in Britain. Ted Foster, certainly if we say that he was seen as a dustman in the most lowly band of the working class, he too came from a minority within society in Britain at that time. And it strikes me on both of these cases, their stories were taken up by people, by the population, with great affection. They chimed well with the times in both cases, and both men being held in great esteem. Interestingly, it is now 13 years on since Johnson Bahari's deed, and still he's in a high profile role, and still he's captured by the media. Well, I'll come to this in a second, I'm sorry, let me go back. This photograph happens to be from last year's Armistice Day ceremony. I noticed, final checking, that a comparable photograph of Sunday could be taken. It was back with the same gentleman. But there we are, there is without doubt. The person that he's with, who is using a chair right now, is Mr. Bill Speakman, Victoria Cross. He won his VC in Korea. But there we are, coverage on television, coverage in the press, our print media, and on websites. And as you will have seen, my thanks to Janet here, it was a pleasure, an honour, we may say, here in Wandsworth, to have welcomed Sergeant Bahari when he came this spring at the inauguration of the VC Memorial Garden in front of the Wandsworth Town Hall. There's his most pleasing and affable picture of Johnson Bahari there in the background, a municipal fountain flashing away. But there they are, there's no letter that he, light-haired, is required, is invited, let us say, to take part in high-profile events. So, we come to our close now. That's how the media covered Foster's news in June 1917. Wandsworth Dustman wins the VC. In the 1840s, an academic called Connop Thirlwell, he wrote a mighty history of ancient Greece. And in it, he talked about Demosthenes, who was a notable Athenian orator and patriot. Even though he died many years earlier, said Thirlwell, as long as the memory of the past survived in Greece, Demosthenes continued to receive, as a hero, marks of public reverence approaching to worship. And I have to say, to some extent, that's what we've been doing this evening. As I said at the start of my talk, we expect, we hope, we see our heroes symbolising for us a proud past, and we value the fact that they define for us a sense of character and a sense of personality for us, or parts of that group. So I close by saying, particularly in these unsettling times and an unsettling future, I feel there is a need for us to seek out heroes from our own history. And when we think of Tooting, more broadly, when we think of Wandsworth, it is my firm view, Corporal Ted Foster, Victoria Cross, is one of the men who most closely fills that need for us. Thank you all very much.
Also for some of those wonderful photographs, you've obviously been digging around in all sorts of archives. Just as a very brief footnote, I did meet Johnson Bahari at this unveiling of the memorial to Wandsworth VCs, and I completely endorse what you were suggesting. My strong impression, with having had a brief chat to him, was that he was incredibly uncomfortable with the sort of publicity that he had to participate in. And he was, perhaps like Ted Foster, a rather shy and retiring man who found himself in the limelight, and it didn't come very easily to him. Now, over to you, any questions?
Did Ted only have a daughter?
No. My understanding is that the daughter Then the source of daughter was described by his great niece to me as an adopted daughter. He had a son called Dennis in 1923, and that gentleman, I believe, now is dead, but from him there's a family. Oh, well, I'm going to bring Janet in here. Janet, you actually met one or two of Ted's successful relatives, didn't you?
Yes, at that unveiling ceremony, some of his descendants were present, and I didn't talk in detail about whether the daughter was adopted or not, but my understanding is that Ted Foster's daughter Alice was an adopted daughter. Mm.
You see, it's interesting, the most interesting question, see the picture here, Mrs. Foster and her little daughter. Now, as you know, those of us that do research, and those of us that love history, oh gosh, we're always doubting, not disrespectfully, but we're always questioning, could mean we ourselves are capable of remembering things that we don't really remember. Memory plays tricks. So I only have this message from this one person who was living in Australia, I don't know if she still survived, and she spoke of her as adopted. But here, perhaps that was a gloss on the situation, which you notice the caption there on the right, Mrs. Foster and her little daughter. I say they explained that it would appear they only had one child themselves, who was a son in 1923.
There's another question at the back, yes?
It's not actually a question, yeah. But it's more a reflection on something that you brought up. The name of the tomb of the unknown warrior, and you rightly pointed out that it could be from any of the services, but what struck me was that the idea of a warrior is that somebody who goes into battle of their own volition.
Mm.
And of course we now know that many men were actually conscripted.
Yes.
So it kind of gets over that, doesn't it?
Yes, indeed. I think it's a very interesting point. Yes, there is a gear change. I was with some historians on Saturday talking about remembrance, would you believe? One of them was noticing parish magazines are wonderful source, wonderful is a tapless turn of phrase, are fascinating sources of this period. Some parish magazines suspended their rolls of honour after 1916. Not saying that people after 1916 were dishonoured or dishonourable, but nevertheless there was compulsion. There really was no variation there. It was no longer a volunteer force.
And so there was a comment there, because I am aware why that happened, and it was because the numbers of the dead were so great. It was by government initiative. They were no longer published in newspapers.
Yes.
Not because many of the men who had died had been conscripted, but because the numbers were so great.
Yeah.
They didn't want to emphasise that fact to the public.
Yeah.
So I think it would be misleading to suggest that parish magazines and the like weren't printing the names because these men were conscripted. Mm. It was because the names were no longer released in that way because they were so large.
Yeah, okay. We did pick up on that morale point in the seminar on Saturday. This is extremely interesting. It's truly important. If you look at the archives, you see phenomenal columns. The only time we'd seen columns of casualties like that was in 1900 to 1902. Phenomenal columns. They were reported, they couldn't be suppressed, it would have been unseen, but that was horrifying enough. And yes, this attrition of the number of deaths is also seen as one of the factors, that I think not a governing one, but one of the factors for this movement that bodies should be buried where they fell, within a few hundred metres, because to have had the Walton-Bassett effect, for our dead to have come home, think of the logistics anyway, bringing them back by ship, but bringing home so many bodies as the casualties mounted at the start of 1915 would have been horrific. So I think you're raising a very interesting point that there was definitely some management of the popular psyche because morale was so fragile, of course.
I'm reading a novel by Robert Edgware. Robert Edrick, who, now admittedly it's a novel, but he's written a lot about the First World War, and I think they're quite well researched.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't read very far into it, but it's a special person, I think, and he's actually in front and responsible for reinterring people. And this is happening in a lot of different cemeteries. Bodies or bits of bodies that are being sent to
Yes.
And he, more or less, this chap in the novel, more or less admits to someone else that although the names are right, the names are, well, very doubtful what those were.
Yes.
Because often they're not whole bodies.
No.
And sometimes there might be a scrap of you or somebody's memories. Sometimes almost nothing that you've really got to attach to.
Yes.
The remains that you're putting into the grave. But of course people wanted graves. They wanted to go and visit graves.
They did, yes.
And maybe you have to give them something. Yeah,
post-war tourism, that's an interesting study in its own terms. Thomas Cook and the Michelin guides, people, of course we're talking about middle class people, those who could afford it, will be going across. Not to claim that, any attempt to bring the remains back, but to visit those remains. Vera Brittain and Winifred Hope went across to northern Italy for, I think, Britain's brother, to see his remains there. So yes, that really is very interesting. But we think, of course we know the full horror of how it panned out. There were those who died, some bodies were returned in late 1914, but of course you had to pay for it, so there was a sense of a class division, that the working class volunteer soldiers maybe just returned there, whereas middle class people could bring back. Very powerful scene in Upstairs, Downstairs, a variant of this, if you may recall. Lady Marjorie sent a motor ambulance across northern France to bring her son back. Well, that didn't happen much, but it did in 1914. And the book which I'm urged to read, not done yet, is Empires of the Dead. And it's about the story of Franklin, I think is his first name. Ware is the second name. And he was working for the British Red Cross in northern France, and he was distressed, perhaps partly as a result of faith as well as illness, distressed that the first casualties, Battle of the Louvre and such like, there was very little efficient recording. And this is linking with yourself, really. I mean your own comments, people. There was very little, there was no system to how to identify who was dead and where they were dead. And so he seems almost single-handed, certainly on his initiative. There is a structure which turned into this enormous bureaucracy of the benign sect, which became the Imperial War Graves Commission, where it was absolutely seen as an act of faith to try and identify remains from the tags, maybe, and to inter them as best you could. But then there is, this, as you know, Thiepval's, a case in point where the war returned, and so the interim cemeteries were destroyed. That's how we've lost records now.
It seems, from what you're saying about the hero worship, seems the wrong word, but a friend of mine had a book of soldiers who died, who'd been awarded two VCs. There weren't many of them, but he had a book.
Yeah.
And we went to Ypres, and we went to the Menin Game, and spent the day driving around, and something struck me that the odd graves, and identical, we were in a cemetery full of, I think I've mentioned this before, a cemetery full of identical graves, captains next to privates, it was all over. The VC graves had a very, very slight bevel.
Oh.
Different. It was almost imperceptible, and if anybody could tell me whether they think it's true, I noticed this, but whether it was just something I'd noticed on a few graves, I can't say.
Mm.
But the VC graves had a very, very slight bevel.
Ah.
It was almost like a hat tip from,
yes.
from those. And so it was interesting you were saying about the hero worship. Mm. It was almost just, they all deserved the best.
Mm.
Deserved the very best.
Yeah. And of course, it was a distinguishing feature in the First World War that. Taking account of what you're saying, that the gravestones were, in essence, were identical, irrespective of your rank within the services. And again, the language, a couple of the medievalists, known Rudyard Kipling, known only unto God. And their name liveth forevermore. Now that's from the Apocrypha, Ecclesiastes, I think. So blurring the line slightly, medievalism and biblical reference, but our language, our terminology, just builds on that mystique. What I don't know, I'm a British historian, what I don't know is how other countries approach their problems, certainly those outside the empire, now the Commonwealth. How the American did, the German did, I'm not sure the manner in which it's.
I didn't know whether the poppy was a symbol only in the UK.
Well, it
seems.
UK Commonwealth, it seems, yes. The first poppies were sold in 1921. Hague felt that there should be a fund for servicemen. That became the British Legion in 1921. And apparently we bought a large stock of poppies from a flower manufacturing service in France. And so by 1922 it stopped distributing. Well, it really wasn't appropriate that we should be making them here. So the poppy factory in Richmond dates from 1922. France now, of course, has the Le Bleu problem, my French Le Bleu, the corn flower, I believe, is their memorial flower. I've seen, by coincidence, my partner and I were in Jamaica one minute, and that was a very moving experience. We went to Remembrance Day in Ocho Rios, and likewise, poppies were on Sydney this weekend, Sydney Opera House. Poppies were projected there, so in the Commonwealth. But the United States don't recognise it as such. A New York friend was over in November about 10 years ago and said to the Dillard, "So, what's the story about the flower?" And the two of us are practically breathing out of paper bags. It is so drilled within us, so culturally, I have to say, for many of us, majority of us in Britain, poppy is just so heart and soul that to have it challenged, like by FIFA last year, to have this wonderful New York friend not following, why has everyone got these on? It's quite startling. Pride goes before our fall, but it's quite startling to think that other nations don't view it in the same way as we do. Virtually a sacred symbol.
Neil, thank you very much for answering a lot of questions.
I was with Jeff Simmons at the weekend on his walk of remembrance around Somerstown, and he mentioned on that walk that next year a massive great memorial is to be unveiled in France, in the town. And it's going to stand 15 foot high. A major ceremony of remembrance for Ted Foster is to occur, and I understand the Mayor of Wandsworth, at his own expense, will be going out as part of those commemorations. So the spirit of Ted Foster lives on 100 years later, and the thankfulness of the local community will be evident on that occasion.
Well, thank you again, Neil, for a wonderful talk, and obviously a lot of people have a lot of questions, so you've sort of reached out to us, and on behalf of the group, I'd like to by the way, this time next year, we will have a speaker from the Commonwealth War Graves Commission coming to speak to us. And just a few brief announcements before...